Can you hear me in the back?
Yes.
Okay, forget about this. My name is Will Holton, and I may be known as Wilfred in the program, but only my mother would really like that name. I want to apologize for moving through slides pretty quickly, but I want to give you the gist of the complex story of filling the back bay as best I can. And I'm just going to come over here. This is based on a 2006 book. My co-author would be here, but he's living in California now. And that's difficult. When I told him about a history camp, he thought I was crazy. But I said, it'll probably be in California, so look for it. The back bay before the filling, this is a Revolutionary War period map. The Back Bay is everything above my hand here. The Charles River, you have to draw over to the upper part and around the peninsula that was Boston. The rest of it below that line is Back Bay. This is a very small, low peninsula called Bradley Point that stuck out into the Back Bay Marsh about where Massachusetts Avenue is now. Now, we'll go back 580 million years. But this gives you an idea of how the bedrock below the Back Bay, below this whole area of the Boston Basin, was created, starting back at that period of time, before there were any one-celled creatures and so on, but pre-Cambrian. My co-author was the geologist, so you'll get a very short version of it from me. There were volcanoes in Dedham and even in West Roxbury. And maybe they were extinct by this time, but they were high mountains, and the rivers from the rain were bringing the stones down in streams, as they do from glaciers today, from mountains today. Those stones and sand and mud particles were going out into a sea. This was part of a piece of land that was floating on the magma and later combined with other parts and eventually got wedged in under what was then extent of the North American plate. And so close to the shore was large gravel and stones. And eventually all of this would be covered by lots and lots of weight of other material, and it would all combine into rocks. But where there were the larger stones became Roxbury conglomerate, or Roxbury pudding stone, as it's more commonly known here in Boston, and Brookline and Newton, parts of Newton and so forth. And then the sand and the silt and clay turned into an argillite or a slate, the Cambridge slate, which doesn't come to the surface as much as the Roxbury pudding stone does. But it's beneath the Back Bay and comes up in parts of Cambridge, that's how it got this name, and parts, I believe, of Medford and so forth, that comes above the surface. So we're done with 580 million years back, and we'll move up some. The glaciers came in much more at different periods, but this is the most recent glaciation. Didn't back off from Boston until about 12 million years ago, which is just a snap of the finger in geological terms. These are the glaciers coming down from Canada, crossing the Boston area, and pushing out to sea. So Cape Cod is one lobe or part of the moraine of one push. Nantucket Island and Martha's Vineyard another, and then it goes all the way down to Long Island and so forth to the south. Over Boston for quite some time, several tens of thousands of years, there were approximately 1,200 feet of ice above Boston. Have you ever tried to lift a big chunk of a big block of ice like this? Think about a 12 by 12 by 12 chunk, which is very heavy, stacked up 1,200 times. The weight that it pushed down on the earth and the amount of pressure that it created when it moved southward, grinding up the stones and pushing them south, pushing them out to sea, really quite incredible. And until recently, in geological time, the rebound from that weight is still being seen. Pretty soon, global warming will turn it all around completely and flood us, which was the case thousands of years ago when the crust had been pushed down so much. Okay, now this shows where the bedrock rock is and other materials below the Christian Science Church Center on the left and the John Hancock Tower on the right. It's about 170 feet down to hard rock under the Christian Science Church Center and about 140 feet down from the surface under the John Hancock. Think about that later, because how are they going to hold the buildings in place? They're building on the back bay as soon as they fill it. They can't put, in those days, they can't put pilings all the way down to bedrock. That's ideal. And it was done for the John Hancock Tower. But it was not at all possible, especially when they were stuck with using wooden pilings in the 19th century. Okay, so you've seen this one before. The Bat Bay is everything to the left of the Chalmette Peninsula, which is pretty much, at the time of the Revolution, still the size that it had been when Boston was founded. It had been expanded just a little bit with docks going out from the shore and things like that, but very little at the time of the Revolution. And the Bat Bay Marsh was pretty much filled with water at high tide. There'd be a few little marshy areas above the surface of the water, but pretty much was filled at high tide and pretty much empty, except for various small streams of melting water, of water extending back into the sea at low tide, right? And this is the Muddy River coming in. This is Stony Brook coming in, both of them flowing down from Brookline and Roxbury direction to the west and southwest. Okay? This on the far side, of course, is Cambridge. You can stop me if I skip something important. Okay. This shows the modern streets of the Back Bay and the Fenway areas and shows Gravelly Point, which I mentioned quickly, coming out roughly where Massachusetts Avenue, Hemingway Street, and Huntington Avenue are. And that Gravelly Point was really laid down in the water from Stony Brook and the Muddy River reached the Back Bay and dropped whatever they were carrying in terms of stones and sand and such. And that made that Gravelly Point. The dark line along Beacon Street was a dam for tidal power that was completed in 1821. The cross dam was also part of that. I can see it at the end of Gravelly Point. It was part of the tidal power project. This was the tidal power dam setup that was put in place, as I said, in 1821. Before that, 1814, they had a plan for a even bigger, twice as large a tidal power project, which would have put the mills on Washington Street on the neck that connected Boston to Roxbury and used this whole Back Bay as a higher basin of water with the water going through the mills toward the lower right into a receiving basin on the Roxbury side, South Boston, Roxbury side. Okay, so this is basically put over today's streets, what they did in 1821. I'll give you a lot more detail on that as we go on. Beacon Street ran across the dam, but it was called Mill Dam Avenue originally. And this is how it was built. It was the dam, but it was also Beacon Street. They put two big walls of large stones, and inside smaller stones to basically hold it back when the water was pushing on those walls, and filled it up with mud and then sand, and then put a road base on top of that. About 50 feet wide, and the north wall would be facing the Charles River, as it shows there, and the back bay, a section called the receiving basin, come to that in a minute, is to the right, to the south. The proposers of this dam project said that they could have about 80 mills running of all sorts on the power that would be generated by this. These timbers were found in 1937, I believe it was, between an underpass for Commonwealth Avenue was created under Mass Ave. You still can drive under there unless it's flooded. these are part of the cross dam, that little short piece of dam that divided the two basins for the tidal power. Okay, now, when we began, my co-author and I speculated about how these gates would have worked, because they had to let the water in from high tide in the back bay to the higher basin at high tide, and then close them to keep that water in as the tide went back down again, and they were using that high water to go through the mills, right? On the other side, this would be the other side of it, letting the water, keeping the water in during high tide of the receiving basin, that is the lower basin, and keeping it inside with the closed gates that you see up above, and then opening them when the tide was higher, was lower in the river than it was, and I'll show you in a minute where these gates were located. Two sets of gates.
Those look a lot like locks.
Well, yes, except you would you'd have a quick ride. you might scrape bottom, but it's the same concept. So we were speculating. They got a little man there with a wheel, and he's turning the gears and all that. And he's got to do it at a different time every day because the tides aren't every 12 hours, and so on and so forth. Well, we were wrong. When we found a report from 1821 that described in great detail, didn't have a picture like this, we had to have this created by an artist, but described in great detail how these gates were made, was all automatic. They were a lot smarter than we would have been. It was all automatic. The water is higher at the top part, top view. The water is higher in the receiving basin, the lower basin, higher in the Charles River, so it pushes them closed. And they'll stay that way until the reverse happens and the water is higher inside. That is when the water is being used through the mills and it comes down there and starts filling up the receiving basin, and then it needs to go out into the river before the tide turns around again. Right? So it was all automatic. The water was higher on one side, pushed them opposite direction, and vice versa. All automatic. And this wasn't the only time that they were a lot smarter than we would be. I'll give you a couple of other examples in a minute. The type of mill wheel they used was called a breast wheel. The difference in the water levels is not going to be more than about maximum 10 feet because of the tidal difference, and that you can't really empty out the receiving basin completely. You can try, but you can't. And so this shows at the highest about 8 feet, highest water level there on the left. And you're letting the water into the back of the wheel, essentially. And you're pushing it down, and so it's rotating in a counterclockwise direction. The high water is to your left. The low water of the receiving basin is on your right. And it works best with more of a tidal difference because you've got more power, you've got more weight of the water spinning that wheel faster. Remember I said they predicted they would have 80 mills? The most they ever ran at once or could run at once was 4. So the investors didn't do very well. Until later when they sold the land. And then they did very well. But most of them bailed out, the original investors, of course, by then. They gave it up. All right. Here's another map view of how the tidal project worked. Receiving basin is here to the right of Gravelly Point. The full basin is to the left. The full basin is smaller, but the Muddy River and Stony Brook flow into it, as well as water they can bring from the high tide period in the river itself, right? It comes through mills that are here on Gravelly Point and a couple that were on the cross dam, and it flows into the receiving basin. These two lines that cross there are railroads, and we'll see later that increased the pollution of the receiving basin because the water was so shallow there. They tried to keep it down to 2 or 3 feet deep maximum, any sewage or anything else that got into it just festered there and never really got washed out. And the railroads kept the water from really circulating and cleaning it out as it had before the dam and the railroads had been placed there. I'm going to fall in this chair if I'm not careful. This is a view from the Boston and Providence Railroad taken from about where Massachusetts Avenue Station or Ruggles Station is located now on the Orange Line and the Amtrak. Looking in towards town, you can see the State House, Park Street Church, just down the street from us here, and the Old South Meeting House. Beacon Hill, of course, to your left. And the two railroads crossing, just as you saw in the dam in the map earlier. Okay, so this would be a train coming in from Providence, on the Boston-Providence Railroad. And the other railroad, you see a train way over there, was on the Boston and Worcester Railroad, both built in the mid-1830s. Okay, here, a map showing these in detail. To see where the gates were, you in the van. One was just about straight above my finger here, just above the word channel, if any of you are close enough to see that, in the big van. And the other gates are just to the right of the edge of the picture there on the left side. The ones on the left brought water in at high tide, or near high tide, a couple hours before or a couple hours after, and we'll try to keep the full basin as full as possible, along with water from the two streams that were coming in. And the other ones in the middle of this longer section were to take the water out of the receiving basin, or the lower basin, take it out after it had flowed through the dams, to keep it as low as possible. So you could run, ideally, the mills 24 hours a day. You could keep the water high enough in the full basin and low enough in the receiving basin, you could keep them going all the time. And with four mills, it was about the maximum that they had the power to do that. Whoops. All right. Pollution. One of the three main reasons for the filling of the back bay was that by the 1840s, the marsh had become so polluted that it was recognized as a public health hazard. They had the miasma theory of disease, so they thought the worse the smell, the more disease, and the smell was awful. An 1849 city report said, every west wind sends its pestilential exhalations across the entire city. Pestilential disease. Right? Right in there. Pestilential exhalation. I wish we talked that word today. It'd be much more creative. Right? Now, these little circles that we added on are where there were sewers in 1850, emptying directly into the back bay. And they were still doing that. This is almost 30 years after the dam was built. So that sewage water is essentially not getting out to the Charles River much anymore, because you're keeping the level down to about 2 feet deep, 3 feet deep, for the tidal power purposes. And it's becoming more and more polluted. The same report of when the next year talked about the water away from the shore bubbling like a cauldron. Another report said the rats were as size of cats, which is a picture in itself. So just imagine this much sewage coming out of the old south end around Tremont Street and of the theater district and that sort of thing, and off of the out of the neck, which was just beginning to be developed. So this is 1850. Now, there were two plans for two major plans were proposed for what the back bay should look like as they began to recognize that it needed to be filled for pollution purposes and other purposes. This one was 1837. A Scotsman named Gourlay breezed into town, stayed for a while, designed all kinds of fancy things. Said he was going to revolutionize all the cities of the world, and he didn't have to sleep after all, so he could get a lot of work done. Nobody ever watched him all night to see if he slept or anything. But this is what he came up with. The Charles River is coming up in the out of the far left. He's put a lot of water into where the back bay was.